Dr. Ramarao Garu, Director, National Academy of Agricultural Research Management. Dr. Kalpana Shastri. Dr. S.K. Som. All the faculty and staff of NARM and other guests who have arrived here today. The non-faculty staff of NARM who are here. Chala santosham ilanti functions lo maamuluga panjese vaalani kalupukoru kani meerandaru ikkadiki vachinanduku chala santoshanga undi naaku. Mukhyanga Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan nunchi vachina pillalaku kuda vaallu pratyekanga vaalani pilichinanduku తర్వాత వాళ్ళు నారంని విజిట్ చేసినందుకు మీకు కూడా మీరు ఇక్కడికి వచ్చినందుకు నేను చాలా సంతోషపడుతున్నాను. ఐ మస్ట్ ఆల్సో కంగ్రాచులేట్ ఆల్ దోస్ హూ రిసీవ్డ్ ది అవార్డ్స్ టుడే అండ్ ఇట్ ఈస్ అ రికగ్నిషన్ ఐఎమ్ ష్యూర్ వెల్ డిసర్వ్డ్. నో మ్యాటర్ వాట్ వేర్ ఎవర్ యూ గెట్ డెకరేటెడ్ the place of work must appreciate you, and that the place of work has appreciated you, it's indeed a great honor. In fact, I must thank NARM for inviting me today to speak to you, and I was not very clear on how I could fit into NARM because I am working on something entirely different from what you are doing. We are living in very different orbits. My orbit is on child rights, child labor, children's right to education, and you're working on agriculture research. And how do we meet and how do we skip orbits? So I was hesitant and I said, how do I fit in here? You know, I was quite hesitant to even come. But in a way, at a longer goal, we are all, I'm sure, working for the country, the country's development, the country's future, country's democracy, and we have a common goal of nation building. And in that sense, I thought there was a lot in common between NARM and the work that MV Foundation and I have been doing through the National Commission for Protection of Child Rights. So that was the way in which I thought there was a rationality for coming here today to speaking to you, that we are all here to build a great country and a great nation, and we are working very hard towards it. I am a compulsive optimist, and I feel always enthused and inspired when I look at dedicated functionaries of the public sector and those who are working in research institutions such as yours. And it is indeed a very important occasion for me. Thank you for inviting me here today. I will talk about two things. One is about how difficult it is for the poor to get to schools. There are many school students here. I hope you understand English. Yeah, because I have to talk to you too, you're here, so I can't ignore you. And also, especially I would like to emphasize in the second part on what is happening to our girls, especially in the ages of 14 to 18 years, that is after they complete 8th class, and what kinds of battles they have to face to continue in education, to be in a school up to 18 years of age. This is the research I'm currently engaged in, looking at adolescent children in the ages of 14 to 18 and what kinds of problems they face to get into a school system and to continue in the school system. As you know, our rank in education when compared globally is very bad. The mean or the average years, number of years a child in India attends school is only 5.8 years. it's which means that they don't even complete, most children do not even complete class 6. That is what the average is in India. After class 6, we do not know where these children are. But if you compare it to, say, for example, China or even Brazil, their average years of attending in school is between 8 and 10. So they complete 8th class and 10th class. But in our country, our children, most of our children complete only class 6, not even complete 6, nearly class 6. That is how badly performed we are when, as far as education is concerned. What happens when children do not go to school? I'm sure all of you know. Nothing that I'm going to tell you is something that you do not know. You know, it is a part of our own milieu. When children do not go to school, there are millions of them. First of all, they become invisible. There is an invisibilization of children when they are not attending in schools. It's only when they are in schools, they are available for public scrutiny. So you know that when there is a corporal punishment in school, it can become news. But it was never a news when, say, some 4.5 lakh children in our country are engaged in plucking cotton and engaged in production of hybrid cotton seeds. You find it happening in Rangareddy, but again, because of the work of MV Foundation, fortunately, the hybrid cotton seed production was closed down and they shifted to Raichur. But we wouldn't stop. We started pressuring them in Raichur. So they've shifted to Maharashtra and mainly to Gujarat. So, but there are lakhs of children working because they're out of school, they're working in production of hybrid cotton seeds. You find hundreds and thousands of children working in soybean cultivation. Again, many of them working in sugarcane farms. All these working as migrant child labor. All these have been trafficked. All these are cooped in trucks and taken from one place to the other. And they are, in fact, working, or they are made to work, not because they are poor, not because their families need their income. It's a big myth that children are working because they are poor. Children are made to work because they are a source of cheap labor. If they had to employ adults instead of children, then they would have to pay daily a wage of at least 150 rupees to 200 rupees. But if you employ children, you can get away without paying any wage. You can employ them on the promise of giving them a wage. Usually, the families are given an advance of some 2,000 to 3,000 rupees, and then these children are sent away. Most of them are girls. There are boys also who work on these farms, and boys also do very heavy work on construction sites, on road laying, on brick kilns. So you find that when a child is not in school, she's trafficked. Most of them work in agriculture. And I sometimes wonder if there can be a research where it is less labor intensive, then therefore children are actually not in demand in the labor force and they can go to school. You know, I really wonder if we can do something like that. But then agriculture is very labor intensive. These girls who pluck cotton are almost doing cross-pollination, and they work like butterflies. Their role is a role of a butterfly. They do rubbing of every flower with the, you must say what the scientific thing, with the ovary, you know. Every flower is pollinated to produce the right kind of hybrid cotton seeds. And it's intense, labor intensive under the hot sun. I also tried twice for about 1 week to see how difficult it is to in fact grow paddy, you know, and dig your feet in slush, and to stand there, to bend and to keep sowing. Millions of girls do that, you know, they're part of that sowing activity. Within 2 days I had blisters in my feet. And these children dig their legs at least for about 15 days to 1 month, and by the time they finish, their legs are like peeling off. You know, and we don't know that the grain we eat, that the rice we eat, is so much dependent on women and children who work where their backs break. And when their feet are just impossible, it takes at least 3 to 4 months for the feet to look normal and to heal. And this is what happens when children don't go to school. They, of course, I mean, I always say that your lives and the lives and my life are so interdependent with children who are out of school. But we don't recognize that much. We think they're out there and we have nothing to do with them. But if you look at the three things, roti, kapda and makan, none of these are produced without child labor. I just talked to you about cotton. We would not be sitting here with our clothes on if we said let's ban child labor in production of cotton. So they make us look dignified with their loss of dignity. I went to Tirupur 2 months ago. There were only children working in the garment factories, making shirts and t-shirts. Only children. Hundreds and thousands of them working there. All cooped in small, small rooms. And most of them are girls. So our kapda is children. Our roti is children. Because it is so labor intensive, children come as cheap labor and we have our roti as children. And brick by brick, you find children who are there in baking them in the brick kilns. Even if they do not bake bricks, the children of the brick workers are without any shelter, left there under the sun. So there is a sacrifice of an infant, his right to food, his right to shelter, his right to nutrition for making the brick that we build this beautiful building today. So somewhere I think, while children are in schools, they are visible. But when they are not in school, they are invisible. I only mentioned three products. But I can tell you, the products we consume, the children make, we made out a list, there are at least 5,000 products in this country which children make, which we use in a daily life. The bindi I wear is made only by children. So I can go on and on and on. The school bag, the zips, are made by children. So I don't want to tell more about how much children do to make your life and my life very, very happy and comfortable. Now they have a right to education. When it is a fundamental right, it is a state obligation to see that children no longer work. They must all be in schools, no matter what. There cannot be any excuse. One cannot say they are poor and therefore they have to work. It is the state's responsibility to see that children are given free and compulsory education. The meaning of free, the act is called right to free and compulsory education. The meaning of free is that the state has to do everything to make it possible for children to join schools. It means compensating for income, it means roads and transport, it means free textbooks and notebooks, it means school uniforms, it means anything that deprives, say if the child is not well and has chronic illness and therefore is not able to attend to school, then it means health support to to that child to be in school. That is a very powerful act. And compulsory is not a compulsion on the parent. It's not a compulsion on the child. It's a compulsion on the state to see that children join schools. So we have a very, very powerful act that gives children a right to education up to class 8. I wish it was up to class 12. It is only from class 1 to 8, and I wish it was preschool as well. For children of well-to-do, we send our children even before they join school in class 1. Why should it be different for the poor children? And after class 8, none of us discontinue our children. We want them all to go abroad and study till they complete their PhDs. And why only up to class 8 for children of the poor? These are, I would think, unacceptable double standards that we adopt. One for the rich and one for the 70% of the poor who are deprived of education. But in any case, at least we have a right to education up to class 8. My favorite parts of that, this is where the real battle is. Of course, it talks about appropriate number of teachers, classrooms, but it has certain section which is very, very good as far as the first generation learner is concerned. The Act states that if a child does not have birth certificate, he cannot deprive the child from attending school. So you can imagine that how many children would have been sent out of school because they did not have birth certificates. And whose fault is it that the child does not have birth certificates? Our country does not have a universal coverage of birth certificates. I don't know how many of you in this room have birth certificates. It's our 10th class certificate that becomes a birth certificate. So even the middle classes don't have a birth certificate. What to talk about the poor? And then you find that many of the poor are not admitted into schools because they don't have a birth certificate. And in lieu of a birth certificate, they are asked to give an affidavit. Imagine a tribal living in Adilabad or Srikakulam or Vijayanagaram who doesn't know anything to come up with an affidavit to declare that my child was born on this day. He will have to spend at least 800 to 1000 rupees to make that affidavit. And since he is not able to do that, he would rather not send the child to school. It's not because he's poor. He's not because he's not interested. It's because our incapacity to give him a birth certificate, not his incapacity. You know, it's because of the state's failure to have a universal coverage of birth certificate. But then the Right to Education Act has overcome that and said that no school shall deprive. It's their right. In fact, many children could not join schools because they could not produce transfer certificates. Many schools are finished by class 5. They have to go to class school to a new school. The new school asks for a transfer certificate. I'm sure all these children know these stories of transfer certificates who are sitting here. And many a school would not accept them because they didn't bring their transfer certificates. But the Right to Education Act says it's not necessary. If a child says, I have come, you have to give me admission. You can later on produce a transfer certificate, but you cannot stop me from coming to school because I don't have one. When we were working in Rangareddy district, we found one of the major reasons for children to drop out of school was there was no transfer certificate. Then what we did was we told the school teachers that it is their responsibility to give a transfer certificate to all children before the academic year, and they should inform the next school that 30 children from their school who finish class 5 are going to be attending the 6th class. Then the teacher said they had stationery only for 2 children to give a transfer certificate. That is why they are not able to give transfer certificate for all 30 children. They had one stationery book that was given to them some 5 years ago, so they use it very carefully. They give only 2 each year because they do not know when they will get the next stationery book. Whose fault is it that the child was not getting his transfer certificate? So we got 30,000 transfer certificates printed privately, gave the books to all the school teachers and said, you will have to give your transfer certificate. And then these children were admitted. When they went to class 6, normally in class 6 they would get, say, only some 30 new admissions. And they would say, you have no transfer certificates, and exclude the rest. The year we started issuing transfer certificates, 150 children to 200 children got admitted in class 6. Then the school teacher said, where do I keep these children? I have no teachers. I have no classrooms. Nithyamida vespote me mevaitam. That is what the teacher said. You know, how do you, so these are the gaps in the system, you know. And then, of course, the act says, this is it. There is no way in which a teacher can say no. Teachers cannot hold screening tests, because it is very discriminatory. You cannot have entrance examination. It is discriminatory, all by law. It is based on the understanding that all have equal capacities and you cannot discriminate from one child and the other. If you want, you have a lottery system to select the children you want to take. But you cannot say that I will take interview of some parents and then select only children of very intelligent, rich parents and leave behind other children. So the RTE Act for me is a very powerful act. It also finally says that those children who are out of school, say who missed out on class, who never went to school, and she's 13 years old, she wants to get back to school. She cannot be admitted in class 1, even if she is a total illiterate. She has to be admitted in class 7. And it is a responsibility of the government to give special training for these children to see that, and it's called an age appropriate, to be admitted into an age appropriate class. So they first get admitted into an age appropriate class, and the government has to give special training to see that the child is on par with the peer. Otherwise, a 13-year-old child will never join school. She would not want to sit with a 6-year-old child in class 1. These are some of the very, very radical aspects of the Right to Education Act, and none of these laws came in there without the poor and their battle for schools. All these was chronicled as the aspects of school that were responsible for pushing children out of school were brought together, and they found that these were the things that should enable children to school, and that is how they had all come to school. And I think it's a great law. What I'm going to talk to you about is the second part of it, is about children in 14 to 18 years. What about them? They pass class 8 and then they have to go to the next class. They have no rights there. They have no entitlements there. And especially for girls, you find after class 8 there is a pressure of marriage on them. And it's a huge pressure of marriage on them. So we are doing a research, and we had tried to find out what is this pressure about of marriage. Why are they getting married? There are again arguments that they don't know, parents are not aware, parents are poor, dowries will go up, and that is why they're not getting married. They're getting married. But when we were talking to girls, we did an interview with some 1,200 girls. We have still not got the final results. I'm still in the halfway of the project. Most girls said they were getting married because of safety issues. that if they have to go to the next school for class 9 and above, they have to take a bus which is 15 kilometers away, 20 kilometers away, and they're constantly, there's eve teasing. Constantly there's talking. There are boys chasing the girls all the time. And the girls feel very uncomfortable. And so the girls have to make arrangements of going in a group from their village to the next village. Say in that group about 4 or 5 are not able to come, the other 4 or 5 also decide not to go to school because they feel a group strength of 10 gives them the security to go to the next school. Security from boys, vadu mammalni banayistaru. And no child, no girl likes to be teased. In fact, there were instances we saw where the entire class dropped out of school because one boy wrote on a blackboard with a heart and an arrow, "I love Lakshmi." Now we don't know which boy wrote it. And Lakshmi was in trouble. So a friend of Lakshmi went and told Lakshmi's mother that on the blackboard they wrote, some boy wrote that he fell in love with Lakshmi. Now the mother got very, very worried. What will happen to Lakshmi tomorrow? So the mother said, "Lakshmi, you can't go to school anymore. If it is unsafe for Lakshmi, it is unsafe for other 29 girls who are in that class." So all the 30 girls dropped out of school because of a boy who writes, "I love Lakshmi." I do not know if the boy knows that he's caused such a serious damage to the girl's life and her future. Most boys don't know because they're also growing up, and they're growing up to become adolescent boys, and they think this is the best way to be an adolescent boy. We don't give them life skills, we don't give them awareness, we don't give them knowledge. And of course, we are such a great Indian tradition we have that we don't want to even give them education on sexuality and sex education, thinking this is against Indian culture. But it is pro-Indian culture to tease a girl, but against Indian culture to safeguard girls from being teased. You know, we quickly go back to our Indian tradition and culture. And it got me very angry when I saw how children could not go to colleges, how girls could not go to schools just because some boys had some fun teasing girls. This is a small type of fun, not a very huge fun like molestation, rape, but then this also, now under the Act, protection of offenses, sexual offenses against children, now all these have also been defined as sexual assault. Earlier they were not seen as sexual assault. But now, because this is the kind of damage it causes, it doesn't have to be only rape for a person to be sexually assaulted. You don't even have to touch a woman to sexually assault her. If you stalk her every day, then it is a sexual assault. I might digress a bit. I mean, how much of this is, I would say, masculinity is imbibed in our values through films. You look at many of the old Hindi or Telugu films. The hero is all the time stalking the heroine. Is all the time making advances. And the heroine is not interested. She says, "I don't want it." But the audience is made to feel the hero is right. And the heroine is wrong for not responding to the hero. We are never made to look at it from the perspective of the girl, that she is just totally uncomfortable about it. That it does not, she doesn't like it. It sort of insults her bodily integrity. It insults her emotion. That is not the theme that comes across through the films. What comes across through the films is Dilip Kumar, Devanand, Nageshwar Rao, NTR being great heroes who are working so hard to win the heart of this heroine, and this heroine is such a bad girl that she will not respond. So we are in fact producing norms of what is masculine without trying to understand what it is to be an individual with an integrity of her own and what she has to do. And in fact, while I was doing the study on adolescent girls and the problems they face, I thought I must not only look at girls, but look at how masculinity is constructed in this country. What is the peer pressure among boys that they show that they are masculine enough? There is a study that is going on in Mumbai, and we want to do it here also. Say there are a group of 10 boys, and one boy feels uncomfortable and does not want to participate in this kind of activity. It's against his emotion. He says, "Nahi, nahi, hum nahi karenge isko. I am not it." And it was a great case study of a boy called Iqbal. The rest of the boys thought he was not a male enough. So they stopped playing with him. They boycotted him. And they said, "What kind of a boy you are when you are not showing how heroic you are?" And this boy wanted to be very cultured, but then totally he was boycotted by his friends. And so this is how masculinity is constructed. So I feel sorry for men as much as for women, for the manner in which we have constructed what a man should do and what a woman should be. And that is what the study is now coming across and showing to me. I'm just giving you a glimpse of what the study is showing. But these adolescent girls, I must tell you, work in the morning in 5 houses, go to college, come back home and work in 3 houses to be able to afford college after school after class 9. Because the scholarships are limited, there are no hostels after class 10, bus charge is 180 rupees to 320 rupees, they are not able to afford it. They have only one pair of salwar kameez, so they keep washing it and going to college alternate days. So it's immense, the expenses of higher education. They're really struggling very, very hard. On top of it, there's a pressure from the family saying, "You must get married. Enough is enough. Are you going to become a collector?" You know, those kinds of pressures on these girls. What we were trying to do in this study is to look at these girls, how much of support they received from the government to reach up to intermediate. We are still computing the data. But what is coming across is, we studied girls whose parents never went to school, and we called them champions. And we said, in these champions, because we called them champions because their parents were illiterates, and these girls studied up to second year in intermediate, so they must be really great champions to make it up to intermediate when your parents are illiterate. So we wanted to know if the support came from government or who supported. Is it a school teacher? Is it a friend? Who gave them support? Very small number of girls said the support came from government. Most of them talked about the support of a school teacher. That when they found a girl was bright, was promising, then the school headmaster or the school teacher would guide the child and say, "Look, I think you are a good student. You can apply. This is the college." And they would even get application forms. So I was quite moved by the fact that there are so many school teachers who care for the children in their class. Although they are government, they're not doing it as government servants and as a duty. They are doing it as individual and highly motivated teachers who want to get their children, because they invested so much in those children, they feel that you might become a good doctor, you might become a good teacher, you might become something good. So I am guiding you, you do this. Many of them said it was their school teacher that actually guided them to pursue higher education. Then it was some aunt or some uncle and things like that. So basically what I'm trying to say is that these girls are also able to study up to that level because they have that inner courage and conviction to withstand the pressure from the family, which is all the time telling them you get married. And there is always an old grandmother who is going to be dying and want to see the grandchild married before she dies. It's too much of a pressure on the child. There's always a grandmother who's doing this, and I'm sure she will never die because the mother of an 18-year-old will be only 33-year-old. They marry very young, and the mother of a 33-year-old will be only 48-year-old. A grandmother is no more than 48-year-old who is a poor grandmother, and she can live for another 40 years. You know, but then this is such a huge blackmail, you know, saying that you cannot study because the grandmother will die. So we found out that was a, most grandmothers are like that. That one of the reasons for pressure on child marriage we found was grandmother was going to die. That is why, you know. So these are the issues that have come up in our study. We've still not compiled the data, but I think the adolescent girls live a very, very precarious life, and they are situated in a context of, as I said, patriarchal values, in a context of gender discrimination, where most are unaware that there is a discrimination. They think they're treating their children very equally, but actually if you go into the details, it's a very unequal relationship between the boy and the girl. And we found that finally, we cannot work only on the girls, we have to work both on boys and men as well, if we have to protect our girls. Most work on girl child is done only on the girls and on women's self-help groups. I think that's just not enough. The entire society must be energized to understand discrimination and not to poke fun on discrimination and not to deny that there is no discrimination. Acknowledge there is. It works in a very explicit manner in some families. It works in a very subtle manner in some families. In professional families, it's usually the men's preferences and career choices that take precedence over the woman's preference and career choice. If that is not discrimination, what is it? So one will have to look at, question internally, that there is an accept there is discrimination and then go forward on how to pacify, negotiate. It's a difficult thing because one has to make innumerable adjustments. And also there would be some jokes about even middle class husbands, if they're being very nice to their wives, they're joked about as being henpecked. You know, that he listens to his wife. As if there's something wrong in listening to your wife. Even that is a mistake. You know, that to tell you what how masculinity gets constructed. That he should not listen to his wife. He's a butt of jokes. I have 5 brothers, I'm the only sister. All my 5 brothers take such good care of their wives. And then the others tell they're useless men. And I keep telling them, look, they have been such lovely men in the family. They are the feminists in the family. They look at their wives as equals, and here you're telling them they are useless. They said the women in the family are stronger than the men in the family. And why not? You know, and why? And I mean, these are the things I think is very important to introspect. Because if it remains in middle class families, it gets reinforced 100 times in the poor families. Change has to come in our family for changes to happen in the poor. They imbibe our values. They imbibe our culture. They're imitating us all the time. They don't produce values. We produce and they mimic. So I think we have to set very great standards of gender equality to enable poor adolescent girls go to school and study. So it is as much our responsibility as it is theirs. And I do hope I have been able to communicate that there has been a gender discrimination and that it has become increasingly difficult for poor adolescent girls to go to school, and that it is a responsibility of both girls and boys to take charge of their lives, understand what this discrimination is about, and support women, support girls to have live a life with, I would say, both emotional, physical, and bodily integrity, and without any violence. Thank you very much.